How's it going, Mr. Mel? Everyone can hear me talking, that's right. Which means that everybody's going to hear that you have a Superman shirt on and that I think you're super. Good evening. Last Wednesday I said good morning because I was in my old habit, but I've been practicing for 7 days and I did it. So good evening, I want to do it again. Welcome to God's house. Welcome to Zion Lutheran Church. Thank you for hanging out with us, right, in between these Sundays. I love Advent because it gives us extra time to see each other, at least most of our half faces. So tonight, you need to have two things. The first thing you want to have is your handy-dandy worship book. This is going to be everything that you have, everything that you need to know as we're going through it, and all the scriptures, and so you can interact as much as possible. In addition to that, you want to have your handy-dandy songbook. And this is the one that has all of our cool songs and our cool hymns that we're going to have and we're going to enjoy with our hymn sing as we break out of the Christmas, out of a meh mentality. Get ready for not a meh Christmas, but a merry Christmas. So thank you for being here. If you would just bring a little bit of joy to people's faces and just turn your shoulders and wave at each other. If you're hurting in any way, we are here. God has called us to serve you, to bless you, to be part of your life, and for you to be a part of our lives. So if you're hurting, if you need food, if you need assistance, or you just need someone to listen to, or you want to buy somebody a gigantic pizza and eat it with them, we can definitely do that. And if it's a big enough pizza, like 6 feet across, then we can do it while socially distancing. That'd be a very large pizza, wouldn't it? It'd be a very large pizza. All right, so we checked in with each other. We make sure that you have both of those books that you need. If you don't have one of those books, wave your hands over your head and our awesome usher team will drop them off. But as we begin, let us pray together. Talk to God. Heavenly Father, we thank you that you have blessed us to belong to you. We thank you that we get to be in your house, in your word, and in your presence. We pray that you watch over us tonight as so many things are breathing down our neck. Many of us are coming from things that were not as enjoyable as we would have liked today to be. We pray that you put all that on pause, all that on hold, and allow us to simply be here, be your children, simply be in your presence. We pray this for you, Heavenly Father, you live and you reign with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. I invite you to sing a fabulous song as we light up our Advent. God, come to us today in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. As we look forward to Jesus coming to the earth, let's get ready by having a heart-to-heart with God. Almighty God, even though you are constantly faithful to us, we are not as faithful to you. Gracious God, we have sinned. We have fallen short. Jesus was born into the manger. Take your place on the cross so that you may have a place with him in paradise, led by the Holy Spirit, at the command of the Lord Jesus Christ himself, and at the light, at the will, and to the greatest delight of the Father. I forgive you all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Please be seated. As God's forgiven people, I invite you to join me over on your handy-dandy songbook. Any song that you want to sing in there, we will see if Dr. Laverty knows how to play that song. Let's play Stump the Organist. Where are we going? All right, our little torch bearer, our fire lady. What would you like? Page 17. Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Dr. Laverty, do you know number 17, Joy to the World?
I'll try.
He'll try his very best, which means if you listen closely, you're probably going to hear some flourishes because he is fabulous. All right, so you get to hit two stanzas. Which two stanzas would you like to sing tonight? All right, so the odds are left out. We're going to do stanzas 2 and 4 of number 17, Joy to the World. And listen, the pressure's on. Listen for the extra touches Dr. Laverty puts in. Improv. But if you look at this closely, it's a story from the beginning of stanza 1 all the way through to the end of stanza 4. And it's basically the hymn version of in the Gospel of Luke when the angel Gabriel says, hey Mary, you're going to have a baby. She's like, what? And it always ends with this most highly favored lady, Gloria. And it's so cool because it's this whole, it's all of it. It's just like all woven together. It's so cool. I would love to do all 4, but then I'd be like doing favoritism. All right, so we'll just do 2. Christina, which 2 stanzas would you like? All right, so the beginning and the end of the story. All right, stanzas 1 and 4 of hymn, page number 5, hymn 356, the angel Gabriel had indicated. At the end for one more. So let's just do one more now, jump into what we got to do, and then we'll come right back to this. All right, Miss Susie has her hand up. Where are we going? Go tell it on the mountain. On page 11? All right, there we go. All right, page 11, go tell it on the mountain. So which two stanzas, Miss Susie, would you like to sing tonight? Oh, okay. Lots of shepherds going on there. All right. So go tell them out, page 11. We'll do stanza, we'll do the frame, stanza one, refrain, stanza two, and then the refrain again. And then we'll jump right into hearing some of God's word. But there's a song that you really like and you want to sing it again, then just give us a shout at the very end. We'll do that on the way out, all right?
Two stanzas?
Two stanzas, one and two. Your bulletin, we are going to go to page 5 of your bulletin. Ordinarily, we stand for the gospel reading, but this is a longer reading. It's evening. We're on hump day. We work today. Any complaints if we're just going to stay in our seats? Going. All right. The Holy Gospel, according to St. Mark, the second biography of Jesus, the first chapter. Glory to you, O Lord. The beginning of the gospel, the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in Isaiah the prophet, "Behold, I send my messenger before your face, who will prepare your way. The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord, make his path straight." John appeared, baptizing in the wilderness and proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And all the country of Judea and all Jerusalem were going out to him and were being baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now, John was clothed with camel's hair and wore a leather belt around his waist and ate locusts and wild honey. And I preached, saying, "After me comes he who is mightier than I, the strap of whose sandal I'm not worthy to stoop down and untie. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit." In those days, Jesus came from Nazareth of Galilee and was baptized by John in the Jordan. And when he came up out of the water, immediately he saw the heavens being torn open and the Spirit descending on him like a dove. And a voice came from heaven saying, "You are my beloved Son. With you I am well pleased." The Spirit immediately drove Jesus out into the wilderness. And he was in the wilderness 40 days being tempted by Satan. And he was with the wild animals, and the angels were ministering to him. Now after John was arrested, Jesus came into Galilee proclaiming the gospel of God, saying, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God is at hand. Repent and believe in the gospel." Passing alongside the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and Andrew, the brother of Simon, casting a net into the sea for their fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I'll make you become fishers of men." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. And going on a little farther, he saw James, the son of Zebedee, and John, his brother, doing their boat mending the nets. And immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired servants and followed him. And they went to Capernaum. And immediately on the Sabbath, Jesus entered the synagogue and was teaching. And they were astonished at his teaching, for he taught them as one who had authority, not as the scribes. And immediately there was in their synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, "What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be silent, come out of them." And the unclean spirit convulsed him, and crying out with a loud voice came out of him. And they were all amazed, so that they questioned among themselves, saying, "What is this? A new teaching with authority. He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." And at once his fame spread everywhere throughout all the surrounding region of Galilee. This is the gospel of the Lord. Grace to you and peace from God our Father, the Lord Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit, who's blessed us to be here almost like 2 weeks before Christmas, to be in his word and his gifts and in his grace. Amen. Our whole series this December, our whole kind of focus in our worship services and our ministry is ditching the mat, right? So if, I'm still getting people saying, "So what exactly is mat?" And that's the thing, you really can't define mat. It'd be more like the vocal expression of emotional numbness or emotional fatigue. That tells a lot, doesn't it? Yeah. It's way easier to wrap your mind around that when you think about, like, when would somebody use that? Hey, you want to go work in the yard, like, make some memories, connect, be around each other, like, scrape, you know, rake up leaves and maybe trim any sort of the grass patches that are growing up? You want to sit on the couch? Yeah, I'm in the mood for that, right? That's where I am. That's where I am. Hey, you know what? Let's all go tackle all the laundry, get it all washed and folded and put away. You know, let's do that today. Let's just go into the weekend a hero. Man, you just want to sit there on the couch and do nothing. Yeah, all right. That's man. And it's so easy to fall into the meh mentality, because this year it feels like we have been victimized in so many ways, right? Things get canceled, and it's not our fault. It's not my fault that my kids didn't get to go to school the last couple of months last year. Everybody's kids, right? Last couple of months, last school year. It's not my fault that for like once in my kids' lives, we actually bought like season passes somewhere, right? We usually skip on season passes to the zoo. It's free. Well, our taxes pay for it. It's free to all the visitors, but you don't pay at the gate. It's neat that we never really got like Six Flags season passes, right? That's kind of expensive. So we decided this year we're just gonna like knock it out of the park. We're gonna get season passes for our family, right? To the aquarium. Right? Awesome stuff. They got this thing, you can put your hands in there and eat these little fish, eat all the dead skin off. My kids hate it, so it feels creepy. It's kind of weird, I put my hands in there, and you know, 30 minutes later, the guy's tapping me on the shoulder, like, "Sir, you gotta move along, and I'm like, "It's only been 30 minutes. I got season passes, I own these fish, these are my fish, they're working for me. You can have them back in another half hour." They don't like that, apparently. But what happens then? The season's canceled. Victimized. It feels like there's so much that has victimized us, right? Whether jobs have been canceled or workplaces have been canceled, fun has been canceled, restaurants have been canceled. We do this gorgeous ministry, this cafe ministry, right? And then our dining room is canceled. It's so easy to feel victimized and just feel like it's all against you. It's all against you. So how was your 2020? It stank. How was your 2020? That's how my 2020 was, right? It's all about how we tell our stories. And those stories and our perspectives are change our worldviews and change even our connection to God. If you listened to the text earlier, and I'd invite you to have your bulletin just kind of open next to you, or if somebody next to you has it open, you know, just kind of look over there and peek in on it. When you look at what happens at the beginning of the good news, the biography of Jesus, right? Mark is one of the four biographies of Jesus that we have. We call them Gospels, which is a Greek, based on the Greek word for good news. When you look at these four biographies, Mark doesn't have the little baby Jesus in a manger, right? You get that in Luke. You get that in Matthew, right? Oh, look at the cute little baby. So cute, little manger right there. Oh. John kind of makes references to Jesus being like eternally there and being born into the world. Not Mark. In Mark, the feel of that biography is like a comic book, right? How many of you remember that Batman TV show where Batman sat around and worked on his taxes with his tax accountant? I don't remember that one. Because that would be boring. I did see Batman jump off a 10-story building, land on his feet, and run off because he was chasing the bad guy. That's exciting. That's just like, wow, I can't do that. Batman's super. Like, we all should know, as God-fearing people, Batman is super. God's more super, obviously, right? But Batman's pretty awesome. There's no episode about how Batman touches grass. Could you imagine that episode? There's Batman in his bat outfit, pushing the lawnmower. Man, where's that Robin kid? I feed him. Shouldn't that Robin kid be cutting my grass? Why am I doing this? Why is that camera watching me? That's not an episode, because it's not super. Mark is like that. It's got Jesus as this superhero, this epic thing. And everywhere he goes, epic things are happening. And what he was doing as he's marching through the Gospel of Mark is he is doing this victory parade, this victory march, where he's going from thing to thing to thing. And it's just like, wow, look what he did over there. Oh, man, look what he did over here. Oh, man, look what he did next. And then look what he did next. And it's right there on page 5 of your bulletin. It says, here's the good news. And here's how it all started. In 5 verses, it describes John. So John the Baptist, he's standing there in a muddy creek, which is the Jordan River. Sometimes it was flooded, but oftentimes it was not very wet. So it would have been muddy, would have been dirty. And John, he's telling people, get your stuff together, people. This is God's world. You are God's people. You have God's word. And God is about to walk among us. Get your stuff together. And when people could have looked at John, they could have said, man, buddy, you really got done over. And John would have looked at him and said, what do you mean? What? I got everything I need. Buddy, you're eating bugs. How many of you have voluntarily, excitedly, happily eaten bugs? That wasn't on a dare. You do it for fun, Ryan? Okay, you just done it to see what it was like? I've had those hot, spicy crickets, right? But not because they're tasty, but because I didn't eat a bug. He ate bugs and honey. And that's not because they didn't have burgers at the store. It's because it was free. It was there. And as John is saying, come on. I'm following God and I'm loving it. You follow God too. Someone could have said, oh, I like what you're saying, but it's really hard to pay attention because you've got like an antenna or it's a leg. I don't know. It's sticking out of your teeth. Could you please just take that out of your, I can't stop looking at it. It's like when someone has like a piece of lettuce on their mouth, right? You can only see the lettuce. Anybody know what I'm talking about? Nobody. Sad. Is it because I have lettuce in my teeth and you can't hear what I'm saying? Is that what's going on? Masks are great. I haven't had to floss or brush my teeth for 9 months. I'm kidding. For the kids in the room, I'm kidding. Brush and floss your teeth. Twice a day. Okay. Someone could be in John's exact shoes. Well, he probably didn't have shoes because he's standing in muddy water. Someone could have been in his exact footprints. And they could be super happy or super cranky. It's all on how they're looking at it. If they're looking out there, they could have said, you know, I am the greatest preacher that has ever been until Jesus comes along, right? John could think this and say, I've got all these people following me, and I don't even have sandals. all these people, I could ask all of these people to give me 50 cents, have like a little toll booth for forgiveness, right? They come over, drop in 50 cents, I forgive them, they go back, mess up their life, they go through the toll booth again, I get 50 cents, they go back, they mess up their life, they go through the toll booth again. I can get 50 cents off every person that comes over here for forgiveness without having to go like through the whole sacrifice thing at the temple, and I would be loaded, and I can have silk suits, I can have a house instead of sleeping under that tree over there, I can actually get like something to keep my feet from always being wet. I could actually hire an assistant who could help baptize, and I could take every third day off. And he could have been cranky about it. But he knew that he's walking with somebody even greater than he who's going to baptize with the Holy Spirit. He knew, and he was excited about his bugs. He was excited about his honey. He was excited about seeing crowds of people come to get free forgiveness, making no donation at all. He was excited about it because he saw whom he was with. And he was with Jesus. And Jesus always marches to victory. And so when John saw the bugs and the honey and the mud and the crankiness and the skeptics, he was overjoyed because he was paying attention to the bigger picture, that he was with Jesus in the victory march. So as Jesus gets baptized, John got to see that. And then he moves on and he starts gathering people after he beats Satan up in the wilderness, right? They have a little sparring competition and Jesus wins. Anybody surprised? Okay, yeah, because Jesus always wins. It's a victory march. And so then he sees Andrew and his brother Simon, whom we know more often as Peter. And he says to them, hey, quit your job, lose your benefits, walk away from your inheritance, follow me. Be a part of this thing that you have no idea if it's going to work. Follow me. Now, you could have stood in their sandals and interpreted this moment two different ways. One, this Jesus is asking me to make Dad mad and lose my inheritance. This Jesus is telling me to follow him. And he's Jesus, how can I argue? But he's taking me away from my inheritance. He's taking me away from my family. He's taking me away from having my fishing company. And if we just do this fishing thing long enough, and Dad's too tired to do this, then my brother and I, we could be where my dad was, and other people could do the fishing for us. So all we have to do is spend the money other people make for us because we own the boats and we're the bosses. And Jesus wants us to walk away from that. So what, we can be nomads, wandering around like homeless people and watch him forgive people and maybe do a cool thing here and there? Man, I don't know. I kind of like sleeping in my own bed. Anybody else like sleeping in your own bed? It's comfortable, right? Except they didn't really have hotels that Jesus would often sleep in. They would sleep outside. Huh. Or you could be in those sandals and say, the guy who is healing people and has the authority to forgive people with heaven's endorsement, he wants me to be in his parade? He wants me to walk with him? Same exact situation. One's paying attention to every single thing they could complain about. The other one is paying attention to what God is making them a part of. Last example, Jesus walks into a synagogue. And James, and John, and Andrew, and Peter, also known as Simon, are there. And a guy with this demon possession, he's possessed by a demon, which does happen, not so much in America, because people don't usually invite spirits to take over their lives here in America. In other parts of the world, they do, but not in America. It's very counter-American culture. But in other parts of the world, demon possessions are still very common. And Christian missionaries oftentimes easily just walk in, cast out the demon, and everything's fine. It's a beautiful thing to be part of the victory march. Amen? So Jesus walks into the synagogue, and this guy with the demon goes, oh, man! Why are you getting up in my stuff? Why are you up in my grill? Why are you messing around with me? I got this good thing going. Is it the end of the world yet? No, then go away. I don't want you to mess with this thing. I got a good thing going here. The guy, though, when he's healed of this demon possession, we don't hear too much about him, but because of that situation, the whole community, all the witnesses are like, wow. this guy's more super than Superman. This guy's even more super than Batman. This is incredible. When you look at this text, everybody is caught up. Not on everything that we can complain about, but caught up on everything that they're being brought into by doing life with Jesus. That Jesus would invite them into his victory parade, the superhero parade. There's one person, though, in this text that's complaining, and that's the demon. Because nothing God does is ever going to be the thing demons would call right or good or enough. If you're complaining, I'm not saying you're a demon. Okay, to be very clear, if you're complaining, I'm not saying you're like a demon or that you're demon-possessed. The reason why I bring this up, though, is the demon doesn't want to be in the victory parade, the victory march of God. But everybody else was overwhelmed with how amazing it was that Jesus would want to be connected to them. That all of a sudden the inconveniences, well, they didn't matter as much. So bringing this all together, the point I'm going to make tonight. We can look at 2020 and say, what a terrible year. I hope it's a once-in-a-lifetime event and we never have to deal with this kind of stuff again. I hope it's just smooth sailing for the rest of my life. And just, oh man, what a nightmare. The best thing that 2020 can do is end. And we can call the whole year a waste. Or, because we're paying attention to everything we don't like. Or, we can pay attention to the bigger picture. We're getting through another year connected to and closer to God. For me as a pastor, the rest of my ministry, I'm going to be even more resilient because I have traumatically experienced church being canceled for 2.5 months, and yet still, here we are. And last I looked, there are still even the extras of poinsettias and lit up Christmas trees behind me. You're still there. Okay. Sometimes thieves be really sneaky and sneak in when you hear me and all your stuff's gone, right? Like the Grinch. The Grinch didn't come and take our trees, I hope. We're here. Which means the next time some big catastrophic global event happens, me and all the other pastors who are called to serve and encourage God's people are going to be far more equipped and far more able to say, it's going to be okay. And we know that from the very bottom of our hearts because not only does God's word say it, but he has proven it to us. I feel bad for all those people who aren't pastors yet because they don't know how to get involved. We actually have a seminary in fourth year, so you're like, what, 5 months away from being a pastor somewhere? That's awesome. I'm so excited for you. Another thing that has happened for me as your servant, brother in Christ, is I always knew this is true. I always knew this is how the relationship is, but I feel it a lot more. I feel it a lot more. It has changed how I talk with God and how I interact with God and how I plan worship services and sermons. Before, my relationship with God was far more like CEO and then like employee, right? Like, this is his church, I work for him, we do what he wants. Or king and subject, or even father and son. Loving father and son who tries to be obedient. But when our church is closed, and I'm the only one here on a Sunday morning, when it feels like it is just down to you and God, that changes you. And for me, it helped me even more understand and feel and grasp that it's not just a relationship that we have God and worshiper, CEO and employee, or father and son, or father and daughter, but friend. And so before the pandemic, you know I mentioned speed limits a lot because it's an easy way for us to either worship God or to say, God, just I'm not going to trust you in this part. For me, I felt, I mentioned this, and before it was, we follow the speed limits because God gave us our government, and so we do it because he tells us to be better, because if we don't disobey the government, we don't disobey fair rules, good rules, then we're disobeying him, Romans 13. So I got the text for it. But now, I follow even rules like that because it's important to God that I trust him and go along with his systems, like it would be for a friend. If there was a friend of mine who said, I can't see color. Better yet. If I had a friend who said, I just don't like purple. If I know I'm going to spend time around my friend, I could wear purple socks just to say, or I could just lay off the purple. And you do that for a friend. As your friend, Jesus invites you into his victory march. And even if it feels painful in the moment, it's not only pain. We're with Jesus. We're with God. And he's got so much better plan. There was an actual march, an actual parade that Jesus went on one time. And it was when he rode a donkey into Jerusalem. And when he rode that donkey into Jerusalem, all the people were around him and the disciples were with him. And they could have complained and said, I got this achy hip. I don't want to walk on pavement. We were walking all the way here to Jerusalem. Can't we just take the day off? Come on, Jesus. Where's my donkey, Jesus? How come Jesus gets a donkey and I've got to walk? They weren't thinking that way. They were like, wow, we're with Jesus. And all the crowds were saying, you picked the right person. This is the one who's going to save the world. The new King David, the hero, the hope of salvation, the fulfillment of the Old Testament. And you get to walk around with him. Wow. We're just watching from the sides. And here's how that parade ended up. They ended up with receiving the Lord's Supper, getting the salvation of the world, having all of Saturday off. And on Sunday morning, Jesus shows up, and he shows them that he's conquered even death. And the end of the weekend ends up with Jesus breathing into them, God the Holy Spirit, and saying, anyone that you forgive, I forgive too. Your whole job now is just to help people forgive each other. That was a fabulous parade. He did all the work, and we get all the goods. 2020 has not been our deal. If we were writing the script, we would not have written it like this. But that script was in God's hands. And we can look at the things that we don't like, and then we'll never be happy. Or we can look at the things that God has been doing, and we can rejoice that even when the victory parade goes through difficult times for us, that we were with him, that we are now closer to him. All right, so for your sacred moment, I would invite you to have your conversation with God. I invite you to chat with God and have a conversation with him and say, there's things that are hard for me to wrap my mind around, but please help me not just see the negatives, but please help me feel your presence and feel all the stuff that you are at work at, and not just the negatives. Jesus, the negatives always get the attention, and your gracious good often is unnoticed. We pray that we would not just feel the pain, we would not just feel the stings of this year, but that as we get closer to Christmas, we would remember, and our hearts would feel the connection, the closest that we have with you, and rejoice that you are bringing us through another year, and that you would allow us to see that you are drawing us even closer to you. If you could turn a march into Jerusalem, a death on a cross, a quiet Saturday into good, Lord, we know that you can do great things even through 2020. Bless us to not only see the things that we have lost or missed out on or had to wait for, but that we would also see, and even more closely pay attention to, you are with us. And you are on your victory march. You're bringing us with. In your name, Lord Jesus, together we all pray. Amen. All right, as our conversation continues with God, I invite you to page 6 of your bulletin. We have our litany. The litany is it's this beautiful prayer that has been prayed in different languages, of course, but the same sort of flow for almost 1,800 years, which is a pretty ancient thing. It sounds old because it is old. I encourage you as we pray this, if traditional worship is your thing, you're going to love this. If it's not your thing, I invite you to just allow yourself, menopause, and just be drawn into the church in their own languages throughout the world has prayed these words in their own language. These requests almost all the way back until the times that Jesus walked the earth. That's a pretty powerful echo, and we get to be that echo tonight. I invite you to stand as you're able. In peace, let us pray to the Lord, have mercy. For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord, have mercy. For this holy house, and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord, have mercy. For all pastors in Christ, for all servants of the church, and for all the people, let us pray to the Lord, have mercy. For all public servants, for the government and those who protect us, let us pray to the Lord. For those who work to bring peace, justice, and health in this and every place, let us pray to the Lord. For favorable weather, for an abundance of the fruits of the earth, and for peaceful times, let us pray to the Lord. For our deliverance from all affliction, wrath, danger, and need, let us pray to the Lord. For the faithful who have gone before us and are with Christ, let us give thanks to the Lord. Alleluia. Help. Save. Comfort and defend us, gracious Lord. O God, from whom come all holy desires, all good counsels, and all just works, please give to us that peace which the world cannot give, that our hearts would treasure your will, and also that we, being defended from the fear of our enemies, would live in peace and joy through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. Amen. All right, please be seated. Our last piece tonight, we want you to go out the doors with some Christmas jollies. Maybe you'll even be going, ho, 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 ho. That one joke Pastor said was actually funny this time. What song are we going to go out for our bang? All right, Mr. Mel over here. We want to do the backside right here. Let me think. It feels like what? What child? What child is this? Am I right? Yes! I knew that that reading thing would work out for me one of these days. All right, what child is this? Mr. Mel, which two stanzas are we going to sing tonight? You know what? Since you want to, who am I to tell you? No. You want to do the whole song? All right, let's do the whole song as our finale piece. So back of your book, what child is this? All three. Let me just take a moment to say thank you for being here. Thank you for hanging out. Thank you for not just being here, so I actually have people with whom to talk. It gets lonely when I'm all by myself. But because the people in your life need you to connect with God, so you can take this light, these goods, this trust, this confidence, this peace, and share it with them. May the Lord be with you as you bring what God has laid in your heart and your mind out into the world, because it is a very mad place. Amen. What child is this? I bet we'll find out.